Hi everyone. In this video, I'm reviewing a portable RLC meter, a device I bought with my own money, just like all the other equipment I show on this channel. Unfortunately, no company sends me free units to review, and for a video like this, I receive a coupon worth just 40 US cents from Banggood. Since nobody really makes videos for that amount, I'm usually the first reviewer, which means I get a double coupon, a whopping 80 cents. And you can also earn 20 cents for a review photo. So clearly, I'm not doing these multi-day video projects for the money. To keep the video shorter, I'm skipping the technical specifications. You can find those in detail on the Banggood product page, which I've linked in the video description. The instrument comes in this nice, colorful, photo-printed box. Let's take a look at what's included. First, we get a carrying case that fits the device and its accessories. An all-English user manual. A USB-C charging cable, a standard red and black measurement cable, a Kelvin cable for measuring RLC components, we'll talk more about this later, and a special Kelvin-style connector for measuring batteries and other power sources. There's also this weird little plastic piece. At first, I had no idea what it was for, but we'll get to that too. But for now, let's set the accessories aside and take a look at the instrument itself. It's a very nice little device. We'll be doing some measurements with it shortly. I already own a similar size compact instrument from ZOYI, which combines a dual-channel oscilloscope, a multimeter, and a basic signal generator in one. That could have been enough of a reason to buy this RLC meter from Banggood. It looks similar. But what's the real reason I bought this neat little instrument? After all, I already have a 6.5-digit Rigol meter. Here's a photo of it, since it's too tall to fit under the camera right now. And I also have a UNI-T meter, which even comes with this nice carrying case. That one looks very similar to the one I bought from Banggood. It also has four inputs, but there's one big difference. These two here are so-called guard connections. They're grounded shielding points and are internally connected. That's why, for example, the SMD clip only has three terminals. So with this meter, four-wire measurements aren't possible. But what exactly is four-wire measurement, and why is it beneficial? Traditional simple meters measure resistance using two wires, as shown in this diagram. A current source drives a known current through the test leads and the resistor under test. The meter then measures the voltage drop and calculates the resistance using Ohm's law, but this includes the resistance of the leads themselves. This becomes especially significant when measuring very low-value resistors, where it can cause major errors. Let's see this in practice. We're going to measure the 0.1 ohm shunt resistor shown in the photo using the UNI-T meter in two-wire mode. As you can see here, even though UNI-T provides very short test leads to minimize error, their resistance still adds up to 50 milliohms, so the meter reads 150 milliohms instead of 100, a 50% error. In contrast, in four-wire mode, the voltage isn't measured at the meter's terminals, but rather at the resistor's own terminals using two additional sensing wires. This eliminates the effect of voltage drops caused by the test current in the leads. Cables like these, which have four connectors ending in two clips, are called Kelvin cables. Now let's use the Rigol meter, which supports both two- and four-wire modes, to demonstrate the difference. Here you can see the two-wire result, where the lead resistance is added to the measurement. And here's the accurate four-wire result, a perfectly precise reading. Now let's see how the ZOYI meter performs using its Kelvin cable to measure the same shunt resistor. So the reason I bought this RLC meter from Banggood, it isn't cosmetic or emotional like the instrument I showed in my previous video. This time, it's for a real technical reason. This meter supports four-wire measurements. Of course, the Rigol does too, but it's not as portable as this little device, and it doesn't let you adjust the measurement signal's frequency or amplitude like this one does. In fact, with this instrument, you can select the measurement frequency, 100 Hz, 120 Hz, 1 kHz, 10 kHz, and even 100 kHz, which is especially useful for measuring capacitors. You can also adjust the measurement voltage level to 0.1 volts, 0.3 volts, or 0.6 volts, and there's even a bias setting. These features are important when measuring components in circuit, so nearby semiconductors don't interfere with the reading by accidentally turning on. You can also choose the measurement speed, medium, very fast, or slow. And it doesn't just measure R, L, and C. It can also display impedance, dissipation factor, phase angle, series or parallel resistance, and more. Now let's go back to the small plastic plate. This instrument features a four-wire input. The sensing and current source connections are separate. That's why we use a Kelvin cable. The current from the source flows through one side of the clip, while the voltage is sensed directly at the component lead by the other side of the clip, allowing the device to calculate the precise resistance. If you don't want to use the Kelvin cable, you can also insert the component leads into these slots. This still provides four-wire measurement, since the upper and lower contacts inside are connected to separate terminals. When there's no component inserted, the spring pressure causes these contacts to touch. So if you're using the Kelvin cable and want to prevent a short between the two red and two black connectors, you must always insert this small plastic separator, which physically isolates the two contact pairs. This is an RLC reference that I also used with the instrument shown in my previous video. These are its precisely measured values, which I've enlarged for better visibility. Now let's measure this RLC standard. First, the inductor, 415 microhenries. It needs to be measured at 10 kilohertz because that's its specified frequency. The result? Perfect. Exactly 415 microhenries. Next, the resistor. The meter shows 4,998.5 ohms, basically 5 kelms. Spot on. Finally, the capacitor, rated at 60.097 nanofarads. The meter reads 60.094, so it's off by just 3 picofarads at 60 nanofarads. That's practically perfect. Now let's measure some high-precision, ultra-low-tolerance resistors. This one is a 2.5 kΩ resistor with a 0.005% tolerance. Let's set the measurement speed to slow. We can see that it measures very nicely. It shows about 0.3 ohms, less than 2.5 kΩ. Here's another resistor with the same tolerance, rated at 500 kΩ. This one is also measured with great accuracy. Let's try a 30 kΩ resistor. This one has a 0.02% tolerance. Again, the measurement is excellent. Here's a 1 megaohm resistor with a 0.02% tolerance. It measures beautifully as well. Here's another 30 kΩ resistor. Measured just as precisely. This one is a 1.12 kΩ resistor. It also measures very well. This one, too, has a 0.005% tolerance. Now a 4 kΩ resistor with a 0.02% tolerance, measured just as nicely. Here's a 1 kΩ resistor with a 0.5% tolerance. This one is a 101 ohm resistor with a 0.03% tolerance. The reading is spot on, exactly 101 ohms. And here's a 100 ohm resistor with a 0.01% tolerance. It reads 1 ohm lower, still very accurate. And now, here's a feature I didn't even know about when I bought the device. Yet I find it extremely useful. And surprisingly, none of the YouTube videos I've seen about this instrument mention it. Here you can see a bunch of identical 10 kΩ, 1% resistors bundled together. Now we'd like to pick out the ones that are accurate to within, say, 0.1%. Let's see how we can do that. First, let's press the button labeled tolerance. Right now, it's set up to measure 110 kΩ resistors with a 1% tolerance. Since there's no resistor in the test socket, it shows red, meaning out of range. It displays a 99% deviation because that's the maximum it can indicate. Let's adjust the value using the arrow keys. Pressing the down arrow here, we can change it from 110 kΩ to 10 kΩ. Each digit can be adjusted individually. And let's also change the tolerance from 1% to 0.1%. Done. Now let's start measuring the resistors one by one. We don't even have to watch closely. If the result is red, it's out of spec. This one shows 0.16%. That's acceptable. This one's even less than half the limit. Another good one. This one's out of spec again. It's borderline. This one's also out of range. Also out of range. And this one as well. This one is perfect. This one's also fine. And so on. I won't spend more time showing each one now. Of course, this same sorting method can be used for capacitors and inductors as well. Let's take a look at these 47 microfarad electrolytic capacitors and see which ones fall within 5% of the nominal value. This one does. So does this. This one doesn't. This one does. This one does. This one as well. And this one. This one too. And this one doesn't. That makes 7 good ones. Let's pick one more to make it a total of 10. Here's the 10th. This one's good too. So we can say that about 80% of these capacitors are within 5% accuracy. Now let's take a look at a feature that most LCR meters don't offer. And that is the ability to measure the internal resistance of a voltage source, along with its voltage level. When we enter this measurement mode, it always starts in tolerance check mode by default. For example, here it's set so that the voltage should be between 3.7 and 4.1 volts, and the internal resistance should fall between 1 milliohm and 200 milliohms. If either value is outside the specified range, it turns red. In this case, both values are out of range, so both are red. Let's go through these battery cells one by one and see what we find. The voltage is high and the resistance is acceptable. Both voltage and resistance are within range. Both values are okay. Now neither of them is. The resistance is okay. No, wait, that one's not either. So both values are out of range. Here, both values are fine. This one only has the correct voltage. And again, neither value is acceptable. And now let's measure the very first battery of my car. As you can see, its value is 11.5 milliohms, which is still considered quite good. As a cross-check, let's perform the same measurement using a car battery tester. We can see that it shows 10.7 milliohms internal resistance and 12.4 volts. It also reports 31% health and 80% charge level. As they used to say in school, one measurement is no measurement. So let's check it with this other instrument as well. It reads 10.64 milliohms and 12.5 volts. Based on ChatGPT's recommendation, I've set the voltage tolerance range to be between 11.7 and 12.9 volts. Let's see if this battery is within range. Well, just barely, and its internal resistance is also fine. Let's check the second one. This one's okay too. Now let's try a third. That one's definitely not good. Let's check the fourth. Unfortunately, this one isn't good either. Both values are red, and this 28 ohms, that's insanely high. Let's use a power supply to check how accurate the voltage measurement function of the instrument is. Right now, both instruments are showing exactly the same value. The power supply is set to 1 volt, 2 volts, 3 volts, 4 volts, 5 volts, 6 volts, 7 volts, 8 volts, 9 volts, 10 volts, 12 volts, 15 volts, 20 volts, 24 volts, 30 volts, 40 volts, 50 volts, and finally 60 volts. This power supply can't go any higher. By pressing and holding the setup button, we enter the setup menu. Here, we can also see the software version installed on the device. The horizontal arrow buttons allow us to adjust the individual parameters. We can choose between two languages. We can set the brightness level, the auto power off timeout, and whether or not the device should emit sounds. It's also possible to calibrate the instrument and restore the factory settings. This was a quick overview of this little RLC meter. In my opinion, it's a very useful tool for measuring passive components. If you'd like to get one of these handy and affordable devices, you can find the link to the Banggood product page in the video description. Thanks for watching this video. It also took me several days to put together. That's why every single like really means a lot to me. If you enjoy videos like this but haven't subscribed to my channel yet, now's the perfect time. See you in my next video, or maybe even in an earlier one. Bye.